understand, I think I owe you all an apology because apparently I had communicated I was going to be out of town various weeks this quarter, but I did not follow up last quarter or last Wednesday to make sure somebody remembered they were filling in for me. So it sounds like Dave maybe did an ad hoc job. So I apologize for that. I should have followed up on it, but I did not do it. Tonight's the last night of this study that we've been working on since July 9th about the church titled Uniquely Christian in the One Church. And tonight I'm going to try to wrap it up with some conclusion stuff and some stuff before we get to conclusion. Kind of to bring us back to where we've been so far. So what I've been trying to say is that from the very beginning of time, God has been communicating to man what his will is for man. And we can understand his will for man and the relationship he has with man by looking at the history of God and man. We can see what he desires of us today by looking at that history. One of his historical facts is that he's always desired to have a covenant relationship with mankind. He has communicated from early on when a kingdom was going to be established, his eternal kingdom would be established, and that it would be established during the Roman Empire. He communicated that there would be one kingdom, one church, and Paul and John both affirmed during their lifetimes that they were part of that kingdom. So we know from that affirmation from them that the kingdom had been established. Given that, 2 weeks ago we began the process of identifying that kingdom, that church. What are the ways we can identify it? What are the marks you can look for that would identify it? And in that process of looking at those, we saw some of the marks including things like the doctrine or the teaching of the group, the ownership of it. We talked a bit about names, the names that are associated with it. And we're going to touch on names a little bit later this evening. We've talked just a bit about organization, not much. And then a little bit about how a person is part of that church or that kingdom. But that's what we're really going to start with tonight, is that discussion of then how is it a person given that God has clearly established there is one kingdom, that kingdom is the church, they're the same thing. Given that there's one, how is it that a person becomes part of that kingdom, that church? It seems that when you talk about a subject like this or this particular topic, the topic that obviously comes up is the topic of baptism. And that's for some reason, baptism is a tipping point in the discussion. When you're talking with people of let's say, Christian thinking or a Christian mindset, it seems like there's quite a bit of debate, confusion, conflict over about baptism. Is baptism critical to your salvation? Is it figurative in some way? Or is it something else? You know, when you think about that conversation about baptism, you don't really ever hear somebody argue that it's necessary for you to believe. You don't hear people argue that confession is a necessary thing. But you hear people argue about whether or not baptism is important or an identifying mark of the church. So what I thought we'd do, first of all, is let's just look at a couple of Bible facts about what the Bible says baptism is or does. First one, you see a familiar passage there, Acts 2:38, passage that you probably know by heart. Acts 2:38 says, baptism is where forgiveness of sins occurs. Repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. So you can say, by looking at that particular text, that baptism is the place where forgiveness occurs. You can also look at a couple other, again, familiar passages. Mark 16:16, Jesus says, those who are baptized, those who believe and are baptized are saved. He who believes not is not. So what do we see there? Jesus links baptism and salvation together. The same thing in 1 Peter 3:21, and I actually want to turn there because we're going to be referring to 1 Peter 3:21 a couple times here early on. So if you turn over there, 1 Peter 3:21. Peter says this, corresponding to that, baptism now saves you. Not the removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Okay, so it says, Peter says, baptism now saves you. Jesus says, baptism saves. We also see that baptism was where forgiveness of sins happened. But sometimes you hear a discussion, and the discussion goes around Romans chapter 10. There's a couple of verses in Romans chapter 10 that are hurdles for people. So turn over to Romans chapter 10, and we're going to look at verses 9 and 10 and verse 13. So Romans chapter 10, 9 through 10. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. Verse 13. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. So, what I want to do and look at that particular verse. First of all, that verse says, if you confess, you will be saved. You cannot argue with what it says. That's what it says. If you confess with your mouth, you will be saved. The question really becomes then, well, what does that mean? How is it that a person confesses Jesus? What does the Bible example of confession look like? Now, you and I are very familiar with what we see when somebody comes forward in response to the gospel. And you know, any time somebody receives a person who comes forward and wants to respond to the gospel and to be baptized, before we go up here, or even maybe when we go up there, the first thing we do is we stand that person sideways. We make sure we don't have them anywhere near a mic so you can't hear anything they say. We should get them before the back, but we don't. But we do that. And then we ask them, do you believe Jesus is the Christ? And they confess he is, and we accept that as being the confession. I'm not saying it's not. But that's how we would read that verse. But I want you to turn back there to 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21. We're going to look at that one more time. Corresponding to that, baptism now saves you, not the removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It says an appeal. Some people would argue, well, 1 Peter 3:21 is figurative. That it's this, it's not an actual act. It's just this appeal, my heart reaching out to God. I'm appealing to him for salvation. And so this baptism idea is figurative. Well, maybe so. You couldn't necessarily prove your point for 1 Peter chapter 3. I mean, I would argue you have a pretty good stance because you have the discussion right before that about God saving 8 people through the flood. So I would argue God used water to save those people just as he uses water today to save people. But it's not absolutely clear. A really good place to go, though, to establish this confession, how I call on God, what it means to make an appeal. When you make an appeal, you call out for something. So these verses are similar. They're talking about the same thing. Is to go to Acts chapter 22. And we're going to go to verse 16 in Acts chapter 22. If you're like me, when you think about Acts, you think about this particular verse, it's very tempting for me when I get to Acts to be a history buff. Say, well, Acts is all about history. It's the history of the church. And at one point in my life, I knew the ABCs of Acts. There's 26 letters in the alphabet, A through Z, and chapter 1 was A, and it was the A stood for something that stood out in chapter 1. I knew all 26 of them. So I was this history buff about Acts. So I go to Acts chapter 22 and read here about Paul's conversion, and what I say is, okay, this is one of the 3 times in Acts you read about Paul being immersed. And so I am Mr. History about Acts. But being Mr. History is not necessarily what you ought to be. You got to understand what's going on. So let's look here at Acts chapter 22 and read about Paul's conversion. Here's the first question. When Ananias comes to Paul, does Paul believe? The answer is yes. Paul's waiting there. Paul's seen Jesus on the road to Damascus. Does Paul believe? Yes, he believes. Has Paul confessed? If you go back to Acts chapter 9, he says, who are you, Lord? He recognizes Jesus as Lord. Does Paul recognize Jesus as Lord? Yes, he does. Has he been saved? The answer is no. You would know that by reading this verse. He has not yet been saved. He has believed. He has confessed. But he's not yet been saved. How do you know that? You read the text. Verse 16 says this. Why do you delay? Get up, be baptized, and wash away your sins. Now, you can't be saved if you have sins. So that's how you know he's not yet been saved until he did this, calling on his name. Oh, remember, confession is about calling out. 1 Peter chapter 3, Peter says, make an appeal. Baptism is an appeal. It's your call out to God. How do you make your appeal? How do you confess your belief? Through baptism. That's what you learn by Paul. Paul shows you that your confession is evidence through your baptism. That's how you make your appeal. And Paul was baptized. Then he was saved. People still can get hung up in Romans chapter 10. So there's just some additional things on this slide. Go back to Romans chapter 10. People can still get hung up there because it says, you know, so clearly in verse 9. Confess and you will be saved. And people get really hung up on that particular passage. And this is a good place just to sidetrack for a second and say, okay, let's remember how it is we understand text in the Bible. What do you have to do to understand text? Well, you got to understand who's being written to, who's doing the writing, what the setting is. Romans. Paul writing to the church in Rome. So we know Paul's talking to Christians. Well, in this particular verse, though, if you confess with your mouth Jesus Lord, you will be saved. We want to start, okay, who is he talking to? What's he talking about specifically? What's the context of the specific passage? Context is always got this way. You work your way backwards. Just start going backwards from where you are to find context. Go to chapter 10, verse 1. Paul says this, brethren, my heart's desire and my prayer to God for them is for their salvation. Who? So he's talking about somebody's salvation, but who? Who's he talking about? So you keep doing the context, you just keep working backward. So go back up here now to verse 30 of chapter 9. Chapter 9. What shall we say then? The Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness attained righteousness, even the righteousness which is by faith. But Israel, pursuing a law of righteousness, did not arrive at the law. Why? Because they did not pursue it by faith, but as though it were by works. And they stumbled over the stumbling stone, just as it was written, behold, I lay in Zion a stone of stumbling, a rock of offense, and he who believes in him will not be disappointed. Who is my heart's desire? Paul's heart's desire was for Israel, for the Jews, to believe in Jesus. What was necessary for them to be saved? What was their problem? Was there a problem that they needed to be baptized? Well, the answer is yes and no. But their problem was they did not accept Jesus as God's son. They needed to confess him as God's son. If they were willing to confess him as God's son, they would be saved because they would do all things it took to accept Jesus as Lord. That's why Paul doesn't need to say here in Romans chapter 10, verses 9, he doesn't need to say to these people, you need to hear, believe, repent, confess, and be baptized. These previous problem was they would not accept Jesus as God, as the Lord's son. If they didn't do that, they could go nowhere. That's where understanding context really helps when you're dealing with a particular passage. So, confession was necessary for their salvation. Identifying marks. I want to talk about a little bit more about baptism then. So baptism is an identifying mark. And once we accept that baptism is necessary for our salvation, the next question becomes then, well, how? How do I do that? What's that mean? You know, in this world there are various interpretations or understandings of what that means. So what does it mean? What does Scripture tell us it means? Well, we'll start out this way. There's two verses you can look at to give you some clue to what it means. You would first of all go to 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 17, and we'll read that one. They're similar scriptures, so we'll read 1 Peter 4, verse 17. Peter's talking. He says this, For it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God. If it begins with us first, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel? Okay, You know, what would you call that? There's the right word for this. That type of statement is, what's the right word? Oh, well, you know what the right word is. When you ask something where the answer is obvious, whatever that is, that's the right word. Rhetorical, that's it. That's right. He's asking a rhetorical question. If it's difficult for those who are Christians, what will be the outcome for those who are not, who don't obey the gospel? Really a problem. A similar passage is found in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, 7 and 9, where Paul basically says, those who do not obey the gospel will face eternal destruction. So what's that tell us? It says, if you do not want to be destroyed, if you want salvation, you must obey the gospel. So we're talking about mode, right? What is the mode of baptism? Well, we must obey the gospel. What's the gospel? So you would say, I've been trained, you've probably been trained to say this. Well, the gospel is the good news of Christ. Nobody would argue with that. That's correct. That is the gospel. Is that the biblical definition of the gospel? It's what the Bible says the gospel is. Well, where do you find the Bible definition of the gospel? So you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 4. It's good to know, right? You would say, and you would be right, it's the good news of Christ. That would be right. You might even say, well, it's the first four books of the New Testament. You'd be right. But 1 Corinthians 15 tells us what it is. So I want you to turn there, because this is a critical passage to understanding mode of baptism. Paul says this, for now I have made known to you, brethren, the gospel. Okay, I'm going to tell you what the gospel is, which I preached to you, which you received. Remember, he's talking to Christians who live in Corinth, in which you stand. They've done whatever it says, by which you're saved. Okay, you're saved through the gospel. If you hold fast the word which I preach to you, unless you believe it in vain. Okay, that's a bunch of preparatory stuff leading up to what is the gospel. For I deliver to you as of first importance that which I received, that Christ died for our sins, according to Scripture, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, according to Scriptures. What is the gospel? Christ died, was buried, and was resurrected. Now remember those passages, the ones in 1 Peter and in 2 Thessalonians that talk about how you have to obey the gospel. How do you obey Christ's death, burial, and resurrection? Well, I guess the Bible must tell us, right? The Bible must say, here's how you do this. And you would do this, you would obey it through reenactment, by doing the same thing. So let's go now to Romans chapter 6. The reenactment of this. I realize I have probably not found a scripture that is not real familiar to you, but that's okay. We need to have these scriptures in our mind, in our heart, to know exactly where they are. Romans chapter 6, how do I reenact the gospel? Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. Verse 3, do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized in his death? So I have reenacted his death. Therefore we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead, so I've reenacted his resurrection through the glory of the Father, so we might too walk in newness of life. For if we become united with him in likeness of his death, certainly we'll also be in likeness of his resurrection. What's it say? What's the text say? God's word says, to obey the gospel, you have to reenact Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. God's word says, to do that, you do that in baptism. That's how I reenact his death, burial, and resurrection. That is how I obey the gospel. So, baptism is clearly necessary. It's something I must do. Now the question really becomes to me, well then, it's a necessary part of the salvation process. So then I want to figure out, okay, well, how do I do that? Now that we've established it's clearly what I need to do, how do I do that? What do I do? And I get back to Acts again, right? So Acts is a history of the church. It's a history of conversion. There are a variety of passages in Acts that talk about people's acceptance of the gospel, their obedience to the gospel, and how they did that. to me, this is also a foundational passage. When I'm trying to figure out what the church is, what the church should look like, I go back to Acts, because this was the original church. If we want to be the church like that, we want to follow that exact pattern. Look at what that pattern is, how that church was organized, how a person became part of that church. And I want to do the same thing. Follow the pattern. So just quickly, we're not going to turn to every one of these passages, but what we're going to see is that there are, I think it's a 7 different accounts, maybe it's 8 different accounts of people's conversion in Acts. And what you find as you read those conversion accounts, you do not find in the conversion accounts like this, you know our bulletin, right? And up in the right-hand corner of the bulletin, I think it's the right-hand corner, has the plan of salvation, 5 points, that type of thing. Well, as you go through Acts here, there's not like this little box in the passage that says, here's the 5 points or the 5 acts of obedience, or whatever you want to call them, the plan of salvation. They're not there. It doesn't do that. What you do find in Acts is you find each account of conversion, you have a person who's at a certain point in their relationship with God, and they need to do certain things to finalize, to accept, to do the gospel, to obey the gospel. And so wherever they are, they do whatever else is needed. So like you start in Acts chapter 2. We've already talked about Acts chapter 2. There's been this great sermon preached by Peter. People are pricked in their heart. They want to repent. They're repentant of their sin. What do they need to do? Well, they need to be baptized and repent. And that's what you hear there. They got to be baptized, repent. They've already heard. They've believed. They've got to repent and be baptized. Or you go to Acts chapter 16, the Philippian jailer. Well, he had to hear. He had to believe, he had to repent, and he had to be baptized. You go to Acts chapter 8, the Samaritans, when they go to the Samaritans and begin to preach. They had to hear and believe and be baptized. The point is, you got Acts chapter 9, Paul, Acts chapter 10, Cornelius, Acts chapter 16, Lydia, Acts chapter 8, the Ethiopian eunuch. Wherever each one of those individuals was, they needed something to complete the process, and that's what is described as you read through Acts. But as you read through the entire account of conversion in Acts, you find out, I need to do these things. I need to do all those things if I'm going to obey the gospel. So the question still is, how? How do I do it? Acts chapter 8 is a good place to go. Acts chapter 8 is a great place to look because it helps us to understand how. You know that in the religious world, how is a question. We've already talked about how it could be figurative. In some places, how is a sprinkling. In some places, how is pouring. In some places, how is immersion. I imagine there's some other how that I don't know of. But there's a variety of hows people are baptized. What does God's Word say? And what I want to do is be able to go to God's Word and say, this is the proof that says how. Now, the first thing I'll say, and I did not include a slide for this, but the Greeks were very precise in language. And the Greeks had words for everything. And the best way for us to equate that in our own minds is we know that when we talk about love, if Mike gives a lesson on love, he's going to have to tell us which one of these Greek words for love he's talking about. Is he talking about agape? Is he talking about phileo? There's more. All those Greek words, right? Because those had specific meanings in Greek. Same thing for the word, the word that we would use today as baptism generically. The Greeks had words for pouring, they had words for dipping, all these things had different words. And you prove that, you can prove that in Scripture by going to find a Scripture where the word that has been transliterated in our word, in our Bible, baptized, is used and it's a different word. It's like it says pouring or dipping. So the Greeks had specific words. I kind of made a mess of that. But that's okay. I think you know where I was trying to go with that. But we can figure out what God wants us to do by looking at Acts chapter 8. What we see here in Acts chapter 8 is the story of the Ethiopian eunuch. And we know his account of conversion. He's on the road. He's been to Jerusalem. He's on the way home. He's reading Isaiah. As he reads through Isaiah, he comes to this passage about Jesus. Philip goes up to join him. Philip says, do you understand what you're reading? How can I unless somebody helps me? Philip starts right there and talks to him about Jesus. As they're going along, and this is the latter part of Acts chapter 8, so it would be good to turn over to Acts chapter 8. As they're going along the road, the eunuch asks a very unusual question if all you need to do to be baptized is to be sprinkled or to be dipped or something like that, right? If that's all you need, he asks a very unusual question. That unusual question is found in verse 36. As he went along the road, I'm going to start at 35, which is important. Philip opened his mouth, beginning from this scripture. He preached Jesus to him. We don't know what he preached, but you can imply what he preached as the next sentence. As he went along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, water, what prevents me from being baptized?" Okay, if he needed to be sprinkled, did he need that body of water? I don't know what the eunuch had in his chariot. Ben's always good to make sure I have this bottle of water here. I have an imagination that he probably had a canteen of water with him or something like that. That's a long desert road, right? You probably want water with you. Or you know where water's at. So why did he say, "Look, water, what prevents me from being baptized?" Seems like that water was important. That body of water was important. So then Philip says this. Philip said, "If you believe with all your heart, you may." And he answered, said, "I believe that Jesus is Christ, Son of God." And he ordered the chariot to stop, and as they went, and they both went down into the water, Philip as well as the eunuch, and he baptized him. Why did they go down in the water? If he only needed to be dipped, if he only needed to be sprinkled, why did they go in the water? Well, the answer is because he needed to be immersed. Now that, you could say in a way that is, what did you say, that's anecdotal? But it's a fact that you know by reading Romans chapter 6 and understand what the gospel is, right? For me to obey the gospel, I must be buried. If you're buried in a tomb, you're completely covered wherever you're buried at. So I must be buried, and now I see this guy who is doing what is said. He's obeying the gospel, and he goes down into water to be buried. So what's the scripture say? The scripture says baptism is immersion in water, that I have to do that. That is how I call on the Lord. So what's the Bible say? The Bible says that in the first century there were people who were converted, and these people who were converted, who obeyed the gospel, were baptized. We also know from Acts chapter 2 that those people who were converted or saved were added to the church. Therefore, because we know these things, only those who have been baptized are saved and found in the church. Acts chapter 2, 41 and 47 talks about those people being added to the church. Acts chapter 11, 14 through 18 and back to chapter 10, the very end of chapter 10, talks about the Gentiles going through the same process and being added to the church. So, I've got a final question for you about baptism. I think this is an interesting question. Let's say this. What if a person attends a denominational group or some other group? I don't care what the label is. Some group, some religious group, that teaches a doctrine that's contrary to what you see revealed in Scripture. But for some reason, they do teach baptism by immersion. If a person is immersed in that group, as a result of that teaching, have they been saved? Now, possibly the group teaches immersion, but they teach it saying it's not necessary for salvation. On the other hand, possibly this group teaches immersion for remission of sins, but they don't follow the pattern, the New Testament pattern for the church. So is a person who's baptized in that situation saved? Well, that's a difficult question. But that's a hard question. Because baptism is for remission of sins. And if you are immersed for the remission of, well, if you are immersed, fully immersed in, I think that's where I need to stop. If you're fully immersed, have you been saved? Because you've obeyed the gospel. What if that newly baptized individual then continues to worship with this group that teaches things that are clearly contrary to God's will? So does that mean they were saved when they were resurrected from their death, burial, and resurrection in the baptism? They were saved then, but then as they then began their Christian, their walk, their service, whatever you want to call it, with that group, do they begin a slow process then of falling away? Because they're worshiping the group that teaches something that's clearly contrary to God's will. That's a real question. That's a question we deal with as Christian. That's a question we deal with here. It's a question I've dealt with most places I've ever worshipped. Is a person in that circumstance saved? And you know, and there's two, obviously there's, maybe it's not two, but there's two answers. Yes and no. Right? Yes and no. Yes, if the answer is yes, and I'm not going to say that's exactly right, but if the answer is yes, what that really means, to me, that's like a contradiction to what everything else we teach about God's, about being a faithful Christian, right? Everything else we teach about faithful Christians is all about my heart. It's not about what I, it's not about the actions I do, but about my heart, my response. You know, I can come to worship and be here for worship and do everything worship says, but I could be here and my worship be of no use because my heart was not part of it. I was not properly with the right attitude. But if yes is I can be baptized in the wrong place for the wrong reason, but still be baptized in the right way, and I'm saved, that means I can do everything wrong, but do it in the right method, and it worked. That doesn't make a lot of sense to me, to be honest with you. It doesn't make a lot of sense. Bible, I don't know that answers this question. I think Acts chapter 19 talks a little bit about it, because in Acts chapter 19, you have the individuals who were taught John's baptism, when they're taught more fully, they were baptized for the repentance of their sins. I think it talks a little bit to that effect. My only question has always been this, or my only thought is this. Why would you take the chance? If a person has been baptized in a place that does not, you know, that does not teach baptism necessary for salvation, or does, but teaches things contrary to God's will, why would a person then not take, why would they not be baptized again? I want that, I only bring that up for you to chew on. Okay, I want you to chew on it. I'm telling you, the answer is in God's word. What is right is there, so just something for you to chew on and think about. What is the right answer? So, a couple other identifying marks. We're not going to spend time on these identifying marks tonight. The things that I think Gary talked about early in the summer, an identifying mark of the church as organization, how the church is organized. The Bible talks to this particular pattern of organization. So you know the organization will tell you what if this is the right place. Worship tells you how the worship is organized or run or whatever it is part of the worship tells you is an identifying mark of the church. How people, groups handle the Word of God is an identifying mark of the church. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to try to recap what we've done. So we started with this general proposition. This was on July 9th. Some scriptures. Matthew chapter 16, Jesus said there is one church. I will build my church. That's what he told Peter. There's going to be one church. Acts chapter 20, Acts chapter 2, we've already referred to this tonight. God adds the saved to the church. If you're not in the church, you're not saved. God adds the church, the saved to the church. If you're not in the church, you're not saved. Acts chapter 4. There's no other way than by Christ to be saved. Acts chapter 11, people in this church are called Christians. Those were just some of the general proposition. So here's some things we've talked about. God has given us everything we need to know his will. 2 Peter chapter 2, 1 and verse 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. I want to read that again because I think that's a passage that for a long time I've read and thought about, but I think I understand it better now. So 2 Peter 1, 3. Seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness. So again, I have everything I need for life and spiritualness, for godliness. How do I have it? Through the true knowledge of him who called us. How do I get everything I need to be a spiritual being? Through the true knowledge of him. How do I get that? Through his word. I study. If I want to have everything I need, I study his word and I have everything I need. So he's given us everything we need to know his will. It's on us to understand it. God has a history with man. And that's where he reveals his will for man. Through his history, he's revealed his will. Early on, we said this. One of the questions was, okay, he's revealed his will. Can he do what he says? And we spent some time looking and saying, yeah, God can do what he says. He has the power to do it. Will he do what he said? We looked at those scriptures and said, yes, God can be trusted to do what he says. That is who he is. He says, I'll do this. You can trust him to do that. If he says, I'll keep a covenant with you, you can trust him. If he says, I expect you to do this, you can trust it. If he says, you don't do this, I'll do this, you can trust it. You can trust him to do what he says. God has always had a chosen people of covenant. He started that with the Israelites. He has it today. He expects a covenant relationship with his people. Whatever that is, covenant has terms to it. Covenant has ways you enter into it. That's his way. It always has been, always will be. God's plan has always been for there to be an eternal kingdom. And this slide is my ugliest slide, and yet it's my favorite slide because it illustrates this idea that he's had an eternal plan. This is that one that goes through a timeline of creation to Jesus. And there's a bunch of passages, those little, probably hard to see. Oh, they're better today. Those little bullet things are passages in time that reference prophecies. Prophecy in Genesis chapter 49 about when Shiloh comes. Prophecy first prophecy is Genesis 3, when God says that Satan is going to be destroyed. Genesis 49, 2 Samuel, when God promises Solomon that through his descendants, or David, through his descendants, people would be blessed. Isaiah 9, talking about a future kingdom. Daniel chapter 2, talking about the king, the statue, and how in the days of the Roman Empire, God would establish this eternal kingdom. Luke chapter 1, way down here at the very bottom, Luke chapter 1, where the angel tells Mary that her child will be a king. So I love that slide because what you want to see is it's always been God's plan to have an eternal kingdom from the beginning of time, supported by Scripture. God's kingdom came in the first century. That's a confusing fact to people. But in the first century, that kingdom came on the day of Pentecost as it was prophesied. It didn't come during Jesus' life because Jesus always talked about it in the future tense. It did come but Jesus did say it will come in my peers' life. He said in Mark chapter 9, verse 1, some of you here will see the kingdom come with power. So it did come in their life. And we saw that Paul and John both talk about being in the kingdom. Acts chapter 2, read Acts chapter 2, you see when the kingdom came with power. Some parallels we did several weeks ago. Parallels kingdom of church, because what we then tried to say is, okay, we know what God thought of, that God has expected this eternal kingdom. What is that kingdom? I want to say the kingdom and the church are almost always the same thing. Almost always the same thing. Here's some of the parallels we looked at. God promised that this would be an eternal kingdom. The church has been part of God's eternal plan. We see, how do you become a member of either one, part of them? You become part of a kingdom through birth. How do you become part of the church? Through birth. We talked about John chapter 3, what Jesus had to say to Nicodemus. In both of these, Jesus is the king, he's the head. Jesus is the top. Both of them have the same long-term outlook, if that's the right word, it's the thing they're looking for. Both are looking forward to heaven. In both of these, the Lord's Supper is going to be celebrated. And in both of them, the apostles had authority. In the kingdom and in the church, they both have authority. So here's the conclusion. There's one church. This church is identified as a body. Christ is the head. It has a body. Members and congregations are what make up that body. Either way, it can be referred to either way as individual members or individual congregations are part of it. This church, this body, is unified. It's one body, and it's unified in doctrine and unified in ownership. And there's a way to become part of that. That is through water baptism. God also established a name for his kingdom. This was 2 weeks ago. We looked at the various names for the kingdom, or for the church, and all of which refer to the ownership. They all refer to ownership. So a name that does not use Christ or indicate Christ's ownership is not a name that's authorized in Scripture. Some names you can find in Scripture. Church of Christ, Romans 16:16. You can find Church of the Living God. That's in 1 Timothy chapter 3. Church of the Firstborn, Hebrews 12, 23. You could find Church of the Firstborn from the Dead. That's Colossians chapter 1 and 13. All of those are proper descriptors, names for the church, and they all do the same thing. They all refer back to who owns it. So if you find a name for a religious group, and that name for that religious group does not refer to who owns it, well, let's put it this way. Any name refers to who owns it. So if the name doesn't refer to Christ as the owner, well, something's wrong. It's not in the Bible. It's not in the Word. It tells you it's belonged by somebody else. It's the genesis of somebody else. Well, that's not what the Bible says. The church is Jesus's. It's his. He owns it. So a final word. What I hope in this study is that you've seen the importance of understanding God's will. And that you get that through the study of the text. Only through studying the text, the scripture, and all of it, all of the text, will you understand the truth of his will. One thing I hope that we've seen in this time is how important it is, you know, it's important for us to know and understand the New Testament. It's important to understand the epistles because they talk to Christian people. But it's equally important for you and I to understand Old Testament scripture. We can't have the understanding of God's will, his relationship with man, his expectations for man, without understanding or seeing and reading what happened with his relationship to people in the Old Testament. You would not have this idea of the eternal nature of the kingdom, the idea God has of covenant, if you don't understand Old Testament. So when you and I are studying, we cannot focus ourselves. We can't spend our time and say all of our time and let's say, let's study Acts every week, or we can't do Romans 35 times in our life and never Hosea. Because we're not going to understand the whole counsel of God. So we have to understand the entire text. And it's each one of us have to understand the entire text. We've got to read the text and understand the truth, the text, to understand the truth of his will in our life. The words on the outside of a building mean nothing. Whatever words you see on the outside of a building mean nothing. As you travel, and I'm sure you've experienced this, no matter how hard you try, you can find a building that has the label Church of Christ on it that is nothing like the church or the kingdom that's described in the New Testament. You can find that. You probably have. I have. If what happens within those walls, that building, are not consistent with what's revealed in the text, then that church, that group, does not belong to Christ. Now, you can't figure that out if you don't know what his will is. Okay? I mean, if you say, well, that's not how Anchorage does it, that does not mean you have actually figured out that that's not the church. Let's say they have 10 songs for some crazy reason. Because they love to sing, right? Or whatever. Mike talks about Ugandans wanting to meet all day long. Well, that's not how we do it. Whatever it is. You can't compare... I'll be careful with this because I think you should be able to compare us to the New Testament church. But you can't walk in and say, well, that's not how Anchorage Church does it, therefore it's not Christ Church. No, you have to know what God's will is, what his revealed will is. That's how you tell. However, so I want to say the however. The same way, it's possible, it is absolutely possible to recreate the Church of Christ that is described in God's will by understanding his will. So you and I need to read the text. We as a church congregation need to read the text, make sure we're doing exactly what the text says the church should be, and then we are the church that belongs to Christ, the Church of Christ. That's our goal. This was the general thing I wanted to start with each week, and I wanted to drill into people's heads is this thought. Matthew 16, 18, and I'll read it. If I was really good, I could do it by memory. But as soon as I tried to do that, I'd make a mess of it. Matthew 16, 18. I say to you, you are Peter. Upon this rock I will build my church. Focus on my church. And the gates of Hades will not overpower it. Jesus established one church. His church is inclusive. designed to be inclusive, yet it is also exclusive and is clearly distinctive in nature. God adds those who are saved to his one church. Therefore, one who is not in the church is not saved. One of the best and greatest lies Satan has told our world is that it doesn't matter where you worship, so long as you worship in a place that is Christian in concept. Worship at the church of your choice. I believe that's a more effective trap, snare of Satan, than an agnostic, than what Muslims teach, what Hindus teach, or Buddhists, because it's such a subtle trap by trapping those who want to follow Christ, but have fallen victim to a trap because they do not understand from text what exactly is Christ's church. I was really worried that I wouldn't be having too much tonight, and I got just enough, which is good. So I hope you've benefited some from this discussion. What I really, more than anything, I just hope at some point during our talk in these weeks that I've said something, said, well, I got to chew on that for a second. And I want you to chew on it and think about it and look in Scripture and think about it. Is that true? Is that what Scripture says? And hopefully generate a desire to study more from God's will to understand what his will for us is as a church and as individual Christians. Thank you.